They're not carnal. They're not fleshly, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And we come against, even right now, every stronghold, every mindset in the mighty name of Jesus. And we speak it all and surrender it all into the power, amen, and the authority of God's word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Tap those hearts. Amen. Those of y'all who are on, Instagram with us, we appreciate and thank God. And many of you, as we make this connect, maybe you can tell us where you're live from, where you're logging in from today. And we appreciate all of the different ministries and the different pastors and overseers who share. God bless you, Lisa. We've been praying for you. And we appreciate, I see a lot of you, amen, for the very, very first time. So we are thankful, amen. God's word, the entrance of God's word, it always gives, and of course, it brings life unto us. And we were talking about, of course, the importance of worship. You having time carved out of your schedule to study God's word. So last week we began and shared with you part one. We just laid the foundation, if you would, to the seven steps to making a quality decision. Seven steps to making a quality decision. We understand, brothers and sisters, that even in this year of grace, decision making is still very, very important to you as a believer. More than that, to you as an individual. Life is about decisions. Life is about decision making. And certainly many of us, after you've gone throughout life and you are raising children, many of you like myself, your kids are grown now, and some of us now, we are giving that time now to our grandkids, and we understand the importance of making the best use of our time. You know, when you begin to get older, you start, or you should, make better decisions in life, because so many times when you find yourself in certain circumstances, you can almost predict the outcome from the experience that you've been able to attain through this wonderful, precious gift called life. St. Luke chapter 14 and verse 28. And those of y'all, if you can put it in the comment section, that'll certainly help those who are mobile in transit. St. Luke 14 and 28, we use that as a launching path where Jesus says, "For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first, count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it?" We understand the principle of that. Which of you intending to build a marriage? Which of you intending to build financial security? Which of you intending to build a business? Which of you intending to build a ministry? Which of you intending to start your nonprofit? Which of you, whatever it is that you are intending or planning on doing, he says, sit down first. Count the cost, whether he has enough to finish. Yeah, this is in relationship, this is in life. Always sit down first and count the cost. Tap those hearts. That's your way of saying amen, because many of us, we wish we knew back then what we know now. A decision is a determination that is arrived at after consideration. In other words, the pros and the cons. You know, when you look at something, so often you're only seeing it from one angle. There's another angle of that. Decisions are a way of life. So our focus, of course, is to make every decision we make one of quality. Jesus says, sit down first and count the cost. And then I gave unto you also Joshua chapter 24 and verse 25, verse 15. Joshua 24 and verse 15. Listen to what it says. "And if it seem evil to you to serve the Lord, choose," listen to that word, "for yourselves this day, whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whom you dwell? Joshua says, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You see how it all goes together. Jesus says, first of all, sit down first, count the cost. Joshua comes, he makes a decision, because a decision is a determination that is arrived after consideration. He says, hey, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. 1 Kings chapter 18. You should have that in your notes also. 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 20 through 21. 1 Kings 18, verses 20 through 21. So Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. And Elijah came to the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? Can't make your mind up. How long? God bless you, G. How long will you falter between two opinions? He says, if the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the Bible says the people answered him not a word. You know, to not make a decision is a decision. Jesus again says, sit down first, count the cost, to see if you have enough to finish what you started. Joshua says, for as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Here, Elijah tells the people, how long are y'all going to be halt or torn between two opinions? Decide if God is going to be God, serve him. If Baal, then serve him. The Bible says the people answered not a word. Now, we did all of that. God bless you, Sparkle. All of that was to get us to Hebrews chapter 11. And this is where we park. Hebrews 11 verses 24 through verse 29. Now we can really, really kind of get into the meat of the discussion. Seven steps to making a quality decision. And brothers and sisters, every quality decision that we make, you will somehow see that these seven steps are somewhat intertwined. Moses is a prototype of life, actually. Many of us, we move into something, and then many times once we get into it, we later regret it. You remember I use as an analogy, and of course, we bless and thank God for the premier relationship, if you would, and that is, of course, marriage, a man and a woman married together. Remember, we were sharing with you how so often we can be guilty of preparing for a wedding and not preparing for marriage. The wedding is the celebratory initial part of a marriage. But after the tuxedos are gone back, and after the gowns are returned or no longer worn, after the food is all eaten up at the reception, now marriage begins. I mean, think about it. You've never seen an ugly wedding. Every wedding is beautiful, but we also know that those beautiful weddings, unfortunately, can turn to ugly marriages. And that's just in marriage. I mean, it's in everything. It's in school, it's in your diet, it's in your health. So often we can, beginning of the year, many people make New Year's resolutions and keep them for about 3 weeks. It's easy to start something and not finish it. Why? Because many times we don't weigh it out. We don't count the cost. So Hebrews 11, beginning reading at verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Verse 26 says, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he, the Bible says, looked to the reward. Verse 27 says, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for the Bible says he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Verse 28 says, by faith he, Moses, kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he who destroyed the firstborn should touch them. And then we get to verse 29. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, whereas the Egyptians attempting to do so were drowned. Now, you've already made a decision. I want to try to get to as many of these steps as we possibly can in the time that we have remaining. If we do not finish it all, then we'll perhaps pick up even on next week. But wherever you are, you've already made a decision to be there. Early this morning, you began making decisions. The consciousness, once your alarm clock went off, you realized what time it was. You made a decision, either right then to get up or to reach over and touch the snooze button. Tap those hearts, wave at me right now if you know anything about that snooze button Christianity. Give me 9 more minutes, please. 9 more minutes. 9 more minutes. You made a decision. Maybe you made the decision to stay in bed a little longer. Maybe you made a decision this morning to have tea and not coffee. Maybe you made the decision to go an ultimate route to work. Some of you, you went another way to the living room, since most of us are working from home. It's all about decisions. Life is all about decisions, but we also want to make every decision one of quality. And Moses, it is depicted right here in the Word of God through Moses' experience that in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24 through 29, I see 7 steps that we can apply to our lives and our daily decision making and receive the benefits, being able to check it off and say, that was a quality decision. Number one, I want many of you all to write this down. Whenever you are making a quality decision, your first step is to refuse. Now, many of you put that in the comment section if you can. I really want to kind of teach this because so often on the surface, we think that when we are making a quality decision, we choose first, but no. If you're going to make a quality decision, the first step is to refuse. You see, you cannot accept something that has not yet been offered to you. I'll never forget, as a little boy, I used to really look forward to Saturday mornings, because Saturday mornings was the time that me and my mother would go to Swagman. We would go to Swagman. There on Airline Highway, it was like clockwork. I already knew that at 8 o'clock, we were going to be leaving home, because my mother always said, I want to get there before the crowd gets there. And we would leave home at 8 o'clock. We would be up there at Swagman no later than 8:15. And like we do in New Orleans, we would make groceries. Y'all know we would make groceries. I would always look forward to it because my mother would let me choose my own cereal. I could choose my own cereal, I could choose my own cookies and oatmeal pies or whatever. So that was my motivation. I'll never forget how that my mother had her own path. When we would walk into the supermarket, one of the first places we would go is to the meat. We would go to the meat. And I always noticed, very seldom, if ever, in fact, I never ever saw my mother walk up to the meat and just reach and grab a pack of pork chops, put it in the basket and move. Grab a chicken, put it in the basket and move. No, some of y'all see where I'm going. Tap those hearts, because you know I'm on your street right now. No, the first thing you do is you pick up this and you look at it. And most of the time, the one you pick up first is not the one you leave the store with. Because you pick this one up and you discover that these are 2 pork chops, it's $7.87, but wait a minute, these are also 2 pork chops, and they're only $6.42. And then you begin to kind of look them up. What are you doing? First of all, you refuse. If you're gonna make a quality decision, don't accept the first thing that come. You've gotta refuse. Think about it, even when we used to go to the mall, everybody shops online now. But you don't go down the dress aisle and just grab a dress. I want a blue dress, and you just grab it. No, you don't just go and get a purple tie. I just want it. No, you look at it, and you look at this one, and then another one catch your eye. And many times, the one that you grab first is not the one you leave with. Because whenever it's time to make a quality decision, tap those hearts if this is blessing you right now. Jesus says, sit down first, count the cost. Count the cost. So see, you can't refuse something until it's first been offered to you. What is happening in this text? The Bible says, watch this in verse 24 of Hebrews chapter 11, by faith Moses, when he became of age, here's the word, he refused. If you have not circled that, circle it in your Bible if you would. Underline it, highlight it, put it in your notepad. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. So the first thing Moses does, well, it all starts off by faith. Everyone say by faith. And if you can put that in the comment section, by faith, by faith, by faith. Every quality decision, first of all, it's got to be by faith. By faith. You don't want to start anything without faith. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Now, for this to really stick and for this to really make sense to you, you've got to understand the history of how God used and deposited Moses right in the backyard of Pharaoh. You know, one day, I got to tell you this, one day Moses' daughter was out bathing, if you would, out by the Nile River, and she heard the cry of this little baby. Moses was there in a little bassinet. Moses' mother realized that all the children there in Egypt, the male children, were being killed, so she, by faith, put her baby in a bassinet, put him in the Nile River, and pushed him down the Nile River, signifying that she was putting him in the hands of God. Just so happened, Pharaoh's daughter happened to be there by the Nile River. She hears the baby cry. She goes and she looks, and guess what it is? It's a little baby in the Nile River. There's so much I could teach on that. The Nile River was actually known for crocodiles. So it's a very, very dangerous place. This baby is floating there in the Nile River. Moses' mother entrusts his life into the hands of God. Pharaoh's daughter is there. She sees the baby. She falls in love with the baby. She brings the baby home and says, oh, daddy, her dad is the Pharaoh. Please, 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 let me keep him. Let me keep the baby, please. She wins her father's heart, who's Pharaoh, and says, yeah, you can keep the baby, but wait a minute. Pharaoh says, but what we need to do, you don't know nothing about a baby. We need to hire a nanny. We need to hire a nanny for the baby to take care of the baby. I love the word of God. You ought to read it sometime. And the Bible says that Pharaoh's daughter goes to get a nanny to raise the baby. And guess who she go and select? You got it. God is amazing. She goes and hires Moses' mother. So now Moses' mother, thank you, Jesus, is being paid to take care of her own baby that she entrusted a few days ago into the hands of God. Pharaoh is so concerned about the deliverer that God is going to send that he puts an edict out to destroy all of the male boy children from Egypt. But now his daughter finds this little baby boy. She falls in love, take him home. And now Moses, God is awesome. Moses now is living in the house of Pharaoh, which means Moses is eating the best of food. Moses is wearing the best of clothes. Moses is going to the best schools. Moses, on top of that, is being cared for and being nurtured by his own mother, who the Bible says, Pharaoh says, we can't just have this woman taking care of the baby, let's pay her wages. And now she is getting paid to raise her own baby. And while Pharaoh, who is a prototype of the enemy, is out looking, wondering where the deliverer is going to come from, the deliverer is living in his house. He's feeding the deliverer. He's nurturing the deliverer. He's being used of God to raise up the deliverer, the one that is going to deliver God's children out of Egyptian bondage. And now, so watch what happens. See, you can't refuse something until it has first been offered to you. So now we pick up the narrative. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, so he's grown now. He's not just a little 12-year-old. He's not just a little boy. He's now of age. And he realizes, watch it, that being raised by Pharaoh's daughter puts him in line to be the next Pharaoh. Oh my God. So now, Moses, what a job, what a position. You are next in line to be the next Pharaoh. And the Bible says in verse 24, by faith Moses, when he became of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. So look what Moses says, thanks, but no thanks. Thanks, but no thanks. Moses says, I understand the position of being Pharaoh and all of the perks and all of the things that come with it. He'll have his own chauffeur-driven chariot. I mean, he gonna live the life of a Pharaoh. Moses, you next, bro. Everything, the people that's bowing down to Pharaoh, one day they're gonna be bowing down to you. And the Bible says Moses refused. Tap those hearts. I hope this is blessing someone, and I hope this is helping someone. If and when it's time for you to make a quality decision, always understand the first thing you must do is you must refuse before you choose. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Number two, I may not get much further than this. Number two, the second step to making a quality decision is not, number one, refuse, but number two is choose. See, choosing comes after refusing. God bless you, Bishop. Thank God for all of you here. Choosing comes after refusing. Refuse first. Don't choose first. Refuse, listen, is a determination that you come to after consideration. But to choose is an act of your will. It's an act of your will. That's why Jesus says, which of you intending to build a tower? Okay, you're going to build a tower? Sit down first, count the cost to see if you have enough to finish. You're starting out, but will you finish this? Because so often, brothers and sisters, we give birth to these visions, and we give birth to these dreams, and we give birth to these ministries, and we give birth many times to these relationships, but we never nurture them into full maturity. The reason why you need to refuse before you choose is because most of the time in life, your first inclination is of the flesh. First natural, then spiritual. Teach, Bishop. Your flesh many times is going to send out, hallelujah, all of its connectors. And many times your first move is of the flesh. That's why if you're going to make a quality decision, you've got to refuse. Then number two, you have to choose. Choose to choose is an act of your will. Look at, where is that, Bishop? It's right there in verse 25. Verse 25, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He says, nope, I'm not next. That's not my purpose. That's not the destiny for my life. Very attracting, might be appealing to others, but that's not for me. Oh my God, Holy Spirit is speaking to some of you right now, and you know it. God is giving you this teaching right now. Some of you, this teaching is going to save you some time. This teaching is going to save you some stress. This teaching is going to save you some money. This teaching is going to save you some energy. Some of you, this teaching is going to save you some sleepless nights. Refuse first, then you choose. To choose is an act of the will. The Bible says in verse 25, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Oh, Lord Jesus, my time has gotten away from me. I thought I was going to be able to get a little bit more. Nick, we can roll right here. But, you know, let me tell you right now, God is depositing this word to many of you, and you know it. God wants you to make, and he wants to help you. He wants to lead you and guide you to making every decision you make one of quality. You've got to refuse. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. But then he chose. To choose is an act of the will. And listen to this. I thought I was going to get further than this. But listen to what he chose. Moses says, oh God, thank you. I feel your anointing right now, Jesus. Moses is next in line to be Pharaoh. This is a position with prestige. This is a position of power. This is a position of popularity. Holy Spirit is giving me so much right now. As the Pharaoh, he would have millions of followers. Great platform. He would have a voice. And Moses understood that's good for him. But that's not God's destiny for me. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. I could hear Moses says, my time here has been well spent. I'm not destined. That throne is not for me. That throne is for him or for the next throne. The Bible says he chose, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin for a season. We find ourselves right now, brothers and sisters, even now in the midst of this global pandemic. I cannot read this text. I've been reading this now since 1986. Every time I read it, it's brand new revelation and more illumination, because Moses is a prototype of life. And so often I see myself, even in this episode. Moses had a wonderful position presented before him, but he chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. So many people make a permanent decision based on temporary circumstances. Tap those hearts right now. That's a word for some of you right now. I hear the Lord saying that to you right now. Don't make a permanent decision based on temporary circumstances. Because the way the circumstances are right now, they won't always be like this. That's why you got to sit down first and you got to count the costs. Even as it relates with relationship, I mean, physicality, that's good, but you don't become attracted to someone because of what you see physically. That's of the flesh. You need to know a person's spirit, because everything outwardly, physically, all that's going to change. Right now, she might have the figure eight Coke bottle. She might have the figure of a Coke bottle. But after she have a couple of your children, she's going to have the figure of a 2-liter. That's going to be yours. You gotta refuse before you choose. You gotta count the cost. Yeah, can I do life with you for the next 30 years, the next 40 years? Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Thank you, Lord. That's where it got real personal so many times in my life. So many times that I could have made a certain decision that will free me. Like after Hurricane Katrina. After Hurricane Katrina, those 9 grueling years was because I chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. We were there in Houston. It was going to be a wonderful, great, fresh start. Everything was just laid out for me, but the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and says, New Orleans is your assignment. He says, and I want you to go back to New Orleans. I want you to rebuild the cathedral. And it's going to be rough, and it's going to be challenging, and it's going to be difficult, and you're going to feel like I've left you, and you're going to feel like you've been abandoned, and other churches are going to get back into their churches faster, and some of your members are going to go there, but I want you to choose. Suffer affliction with my people. He says, God says, and by the, I'm going to give you the strength, and I'm going to bring it all together. So that the cathedral will be rebuilt. It took us 9 years, but God is a God of his word. You got to refuse and then you choose. Moses says, thanks, but no thanks. I'd rather enjoy the passing pleasures. I'd rather suffer affliction with God's people. And then I love this part, to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. That's the only thing about sin. It's just passing pleasures. It's not going to last. Build your life on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. The flower may fade, the grass may wither, but the word of the living God will stand forever. I've only gotten to point 2. I'm going to pick this up on next week because I cannot rush it. Many of you right now, you are at the brink. You've got to make some quality decisions, and you've got to always understand that many times that first inclination is going to be of the flesh. That's why you got to refuse before you choose. Next Thursday, we're going to pick this up at 3, and then perhaps we'll get a chance to get through those 7 steps. Moses is a wonderful prototype. Can and shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we bless you and we thank you for you lead, you guide us, and you direct us into all truth. Lord, your word is so right. It is a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our pathway. I thank you, oh God, that as we embrace and receive your word, not just revelation, but personal illumination will become ours. There are many, oh God, today who've got to make quality decisions. I pray, Heavenly Father, that the truths of this word and the application of our obedience will bring us to that point of purpose and destiny. Help us to realize and understand that sometime you will even allow us to be temporarily inconvenienced for something that is even greater. I speak that even right now upon the lives of your people. Help us, God, to realize it's not about us, but it is about others. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. I can go on and on. It is so much more. I'm telling you, I feel like a well springing with fresh, refreshing water today. That's what this word is. Aren't you glad that God is not mad at you? Aren't you glad that God is not a God of a second chance? Somebody said that before. God is a God of a second chance. The devil is a liar. We used up our second chance years ago. He's not a God of a second chance, but he's a God of another chance and another chance and another chance. And what I love about God is even when you discover that you're on the wrong road, he specializes in U-turns. He'll allow you to make a U-turn. Tap those hearts if you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes you can be on a road for years and discover this is not even the road I'm supposed to travel. He'll allow you to make a U-turn. And then here's the other part. He will redeem the time. Lord, do it even right now according to your word for many of your people. And Jesus, I got to stop right here. It's not over until God says it's over. And whose report will you believe? I believe the report of the living God. Hallelujah. God says, I know the thoughts that I think toward you. They are thoughts of peace and not of evil, and to give you an expected end. I want you to, we're going to go throughout the rest of this year. We're already in month three, but we're going to go throughout this year in victory. This is a year of restoration. You hear me? God is moving some things on your behalf. Hallelujah. You're going to experience sweatless victories because you're going to realize and understand that Jesus has already encountered all the suffering for us. We can cash in now on the benefit of living a full and fulfilled life. I speak that over your lives today in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Before I even lead you in offering, I want to share with you tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning, Deion and I, we're going to be in prayer. We're going to be leading the people of God in prayer at 6 o'clock a.m. as we always do every Friday morning. Looking forward to it with great, great anticipation. It's an absolute wonderful way to start off your day. Why don't you join us? I know many of you are with us already every Friday morning, but some of you join. Share with us tomorrow for the very first time. The dial-in number is 480-297-0773. The access code is 618-1522 pound. That your line will be muted, but if you're on your way to work, you can log in. If you're getting dressed for work, you can log in with us. Amen. We're going to start off. I'll share with you a very, very brief meditation, and then we'll go into prayer. But more than that, on Fridays, we really spend time interceding, praying for our loved ones, family members, co-workers, relatives, friends. Hey, y'all, let's pray about it. We're not going to worry about it. It's easy to worry about it, but let's pray about it. Hallelujah. Let's get God involved. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. That's what he said in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 33 and verse 3. Now, I failed to mention, but we're going to also be live here on Instagram. We're going to be live on Periscope. We're going to be live on Facebook. I want all of you, of course, share with us tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock a.m. Central Time. We do it every Friday, and then I'm going to have a joke or two. We're going to balance it all out because the Bible says a merry heart do it good like a medicine. Warning, I'm going to have some good jokes. I got two good ones. I haven't released them yet. They hot off the press. I want you to share with us on tomorrow morning. We need a laugh. Amen. So much stress in this world and so much stress in this time. Let me please right now, before we go, I want to lead many of you into our time of giving. We've been in this space now for about a year. Literally, it's been a year that the doors of our church have been closed from in-person services. God has blessed us and he has kept us. God continues to touch the hearts of his people, particularly those of you all who are the members of our church. I need to say to so many of you, thank you for your consistency and your faithfulness. Some of you have been consistent with your tithe. I mean, every week, every other week, once a month, just like you have been over the years, as if we were gathering. I appreciate and thank God for so many of you who understand. There are great responsibilities and needs right here within our ministry, although we're not having physical in-person services. So thank you, thank you, thank you for those of you who continue to give your tithe, those who are giving your offerings, those of you who have given and will give your first fruit seed. We are still investing thousands of dollars into our community, and we're still helping those who are in need, because that's what God has called us to do. That's what he required of all of us, and we're going to continue to do it. So please now, before we go, I want us all to prepare to give unto the Lord. Here at Beacon Light, we've got four cool ways in which you're able to give. Number one, if you want to give by way of text, simply text BLO to 28950. BLO for Beacon Light Offering. Text it to 28950, Apple or Android. Secondly, if you want to give by way of Cash App, you can also use the Cash App $BeaconLight1937. You can give your tithe, your offering, first fruit, or one-time gift right there utilizing Cash App. Third way is, of course, beaconlight.org. That is our website. I encourage you to always go there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Click the online giving and you can always give there. And then, of course, the fourth way is those of you all who live here in the New Orleans area, Gentilly particularly, 7th Ward, I think this is the 7th Ward, 1937 Mirabeau. You can mail your tithe. Many of you have been doing that right here in New Orleans, Louisiana, 70122. 70122. And you're right, Lady B, put in the principle. That's good. Apply the principles right now. Apply the principles right now. Refuse and choose. That's right. You refuse. Says, no, I'm not going to just hear teaching like this and not give. I was praying the other day and I was thanking God because now automatically through technology, guess what? Listen to this. We can give so easily. But you know what I also thought about? In this virtual space, it's also so easy not to give. Don't fall into that trap. You need seed into the ground, because I know that many of you, just like me, you need money back or something that money cannot buy. So I pray God's blessings over every one of you that will give your tithes, your offerings, your gifts of love. In fact, many of you, you're doing it right now. Several of you sow into my life directly, and I appreciate that. If you want to sow a particular seed, you can text BLP to 28950 Apple or Android. And then, of course, my personal Cash App is $BishopDSB. Matthew chapter 10, verse 41, receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, and you will, of course, receive a prophet's reward. Now, let me tell you two or three things, and then we're going to be gone. And I want many of you to be praying with us on tomorrow morning. Let me mention to you, we've been in a series in the month of March, Matters of the Heart. I'm sorry, month of February, preaching and teaching on matters of the heart. Dealt with that for 4 weeks. We're now in March, but guess what? It's so much more revelation that God has given unto me as it relates with the heart, the natural heart and the spiritual parallel. So guess what? This coming Sunday, I'm going to continue in this series, Matters of the Heart. It's so much, and you don't want to miss it. I want every one of you to share with us for our last service of the week. It's called Praise and Workout. Every Saturday morning at 10 o'clock a.m., not too early, not too late. I want each of you, please join in with us, mind, body, spirit, and soul. It's really a praise service, but we get a chance to do some light physical exercises, side straddle hop. We're just going to continue to work and keep our bodies active. I'm looking forward to it. This Saturday, I want you to be a part of it. Have your area already spaced out so that you can work out. Now, we're not training for the Olympics in Tokyo in July, but what we're doing is we're just, of course, bringing great balance, health and strength, of course, to our bodies. And I want each of you all to be a part of it, if you would. And then this coming Sunday, first Sunday of March, I want you to be with us 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and 6 o'clock p.m. The Beacon Light Virtual Experience, it blesses people's lives each and every week. The Lord told me, take my house and bring His house to your house, and we're going to do that. So listen, I want all of you stay, if you would, virtually connected with us. I want many of you to please go and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Every week we are placing more new product, and it's being placed right there, YouTube. Go to YouTube, subscribe Bishop Daryl S. Brister. And if you will subscribe right there to our YouTube channel, you can ring the bell and you will be notified of all of our new content. Each time a new video or something is dropped there, you'll have an opportunity to do that. And then I want all of you, wherever it is that you download your podcast, I want you to also download our podcast. It's entitled Built to Win. Built to Win. Every Tuesday, we are dropping more information there. And I'm telling you, people, business owners, entrepreneurs are being blessed there. And I want you all, if you would, by all means, make sure that you stay connected. Say these words with me. Say, March is a month of miracles. Say it again. Say, March is a month of miracles. Tap those hearts if you believe that right now. Lay hands on yourself and say, there's a miracle for me this month. There's a miracle for you this month. And it's going to happen, of course, here in the month of March. So we thank God for all that He is doing and all that He continues to do. We're going to continue to be used of the Lord with our partnership through Second Harvest. And as it relates with your giving, we're going to continue to touch a hurting world with the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, this time has been well spent. I appreciate and thank God for all of you for studying God's Word together. Next week, we're going to pick up part three of the 7 steps to making a quality decision. I think I'll get a chance to get through 3 through 7, and then we'll be assured that every one of our decisions will be one of quality. Hey, I am Bishop Darrell S. Brister. I am encouraging every one of you, don't fight for the victory, fight from your place of victory. You know why? Because the victory is already yours. May God bless you. May God keep you. We'll be praying in the morning. God bless you. Praise the Lord. All right. Was that